band if we can remove the cause of the disturbance and interference. And this part here, we are going to look at the problems which are on layer 2. So we have a proper layer 1 working. We do not have interferences, but still we have problem, for example, clients not joining networks or no throughput and all this stuff. So we are focusing on layer 2 here, and it's still a very demanding task. You will find out there's a lot of information to process, and Wireshark can help you a lot here. But still, it's like with many other technology, you need to understand how it should work, right? You cannot expect to go there when it's broken already and find the source. You should have a look at it as long as it's running to have a reference. From my first session, I had some good feedback from in the break about some things which have been improved. For example, also the iPhone in the meantime, iOS obviously allows this kind of scanning which we saw. You use this what is the application you're installing? You told me.
Airport, just from Apple itself.
Yes, that's you. That the one you need to configure Apple Wi-Fi devices, right?
Yeah.
Yes. And then you need in the settings you can turn on Wi-Fi scanning. So thank you for that feedback. I didn't have that one. And the second is, I mentioned that we still miss the driver for Windows, which allows us from the built-in Ethernet wireless card to see the monitor and control frames. Obviously, you can manage this when you install the, not Wireshark, but the monitoring tool from Microsoft, NetMon, I think it's called, right? Obviously, a driver is available to see all this management and control frame. Still, you only would have one channel, but you don't have to buy one of these AirPcaps. So this could be, this could help you further. Okay, I mentioned already, for troubleshooting wireless, we are actually not interested in the data. In many cases, we won't even see the data. They would be encrypted. And if you are working with certificates, you won't be able to decrypt it. You will be able to decrypt it, and I'll show you how, if you have pre-shared key available, and if you captured the four-way handshake of the key negotiation at the beginning. Both conditions must be true. But in many cases, I get called to customers, and they work with certificates. I have no chance to ever see the data. And what I'm going to demonstrate here is you still can analyze and troubleshoot the air without being able to see or read the data. It's not required. In normal Ethernet, it's completely different, right? If you don't see TCP or whatever, you're lost. Here, you're not lost because, I mentioned it already in the previous session, every data packet is either acknowledged or retransmitted. And if you see an acknowledge, you can assume the packet has arrived, has been FCS checked, and has been processed. So this is very valuable, and this is something which is, for troubleshooting, is even better than in the air, on the wire, because on the wire you don't have an acknowledge until the TCP issue an acknowledge. If you have UDP, you don't have any acknowledges though. But still, what we have to know is what this frame here, what role they play. And there are about 15 and more different packets, and we will not be able to cover them all in detail. As I said, a standard 3-day wireless class is 3 days. And most of the attendees go home and pull wire because they realize how complex it can be. And that's actually really important. Don't use wireless if you do not need to. If you can pull a wire, pull a wire. Because wireless, less throughput, less security, less reliability, everything is worse, right? We go back to half duplex. We go back to 6 megabit speed and things like this, right? It's crazy. So there's actually only one thing for one reason for wireless, and that's mobility. And we have more and more mobility. As I said, all these iPads and iPhones, and I see a lot of companies now implementing iPads in their process, like storehouses and all the applications. So there is no way around wireless. But if you can avoid it, try to avoid it. You're on the safer side. If you pull a wire, it's stable and it will still work tomorrow. But yeah. First thing which we already also mentioned is we have to get used that the packets look very different from Ethernet. So in Ethernet we know first field, destination address, 48 bits, source address and type field. That's the Ethernet header, 14 bytes. Here we have a lot of different packets from one MAC address to even 4 MAC address. And the reason is, here, when they designed wireless, they were aware that they should reduce the overhead as much as possible. Because these are fields which are consuming bandwidth. They are consuming bandwidth with every packet. So if you can leave off 48 bits because they are not needed in a certain situation, and we're going to see it, in which situation, then leave it off. Reduces the overhead. We still have a lot of overhead in wireless. And that's why, I'm coming to this also, when you talk about data rates of 54 or even more, this is the rate in the air, and you know or have heard of that for the user you can divide it by factor 2. So when we're talking about 54 meg, then about 25 or so is usable. And again, it's per cell, right? If you have 10 users in that cell, they share. And again, these 54 are only if all the clients are really close. Because if you have one client at the end of the cell sending with 6 megabyte, you see the point. So throughput will be an issue in wireless forever. You will never have enough throughput, and that's why here in the design already they were leaving off whenever the field was not required. So how could it work with having a field only one address, only the receiver? The sender or call transmitter is left off. We will see this in a minute how it works. Most packets anyway, the one we are going to see with data and everything, they will have 3 addresses. Why the hell do we need 3 addresses? Because in the air, it's not clear if you send out the packet, who has to pick up and process the packet. There may be more than one access point in your range, right? So what you have to do, you have to state which access point has to process the packet, and that's the first field actually here. This is the transmission direction, so we start from here. The very first field is called receiver, it's not called destination. Why? The access point is not the destination, it's just the next hop. So the access point takes this packet and converts it into an Ethernet packet. We will see this also in the drawing. right on next page here. So let's look at the direction from a station to the access point. The first address will be the MAC address of the access point. And it will be dependent on the BSSID. You know you can have multiple SSID on an access point. Every SSID will have its own MAC address. So a client is associated to exactly one MAC address. And all the packet this client sends are to the same MAC address called receiver. The next field is the MAC address of the sending station, but it's not called source here, it's called transmission address. Actually, it's the same thing here, because the station is also the source. And then at the third point, you see this MAC address of the station here. So very different from Ethernet. What the access point does now, it converts this packet in a native Ethernet frame. You won't see any sign that this frame ever was a wireless. It removes everything which was wireless and copies the destination MAC. We are working on layer 2 here. It's actually a switch. Copies the destination MAC. Let's say this is a Dell. Copies the Dell MAC address into. And now, what would you guess? What would it put in the source address of the field? Would it put its own address or would it put the one from station 1? Any idea? Yes? It's station 1. Access point will not be visible. So if this is whatever an Intel, you will see an Intel MAC address here, and you will see no sign that this packet was not Ethernet before. On the way back, you will see destination Intel, you will see source Dell. And now this packet hits the access point. The access point compares like Harry switch. Is this Intel a station in my associated to my BSSID? Looks like a switch. If yes, it again converts the packet. And the first field is still on the left side here, so I didn't turn around the packet. The direction is the other way around. So the first field is now the MAC address of the station, or it would be Intel. The second field would be the MAC address of this access point. Let's call it Cisco, whatever. And on the third field would be the source address there. So very different. You may think there's a strange arrangement of the fields, but there's a strong logic behind it. The first address in a packet is always the address of the station which has to pick the packet from the air. And the second field is always the MAC address of the station which has put the packet in the air. That's why we're talking about receiver address and source address. So here it's Cisco, and here Intel. Because Intel has put this packet in the air. We are actually talking about two directions. We have two distribution system and front distribution. Another term you may have or may heard. Distribution system is everything, including the access point behind, the whole infrastructure behind. So in the air, we see something more. Let's assume we have this packet transmitted. The way we just saw, we know the packet will be converted to Ethernet, but in the air, we will see another acknowledge, or we will see an acknowledge, and this acknowledge has only one address. It has the address of this receiver. The source is left off, I mentioned already, want to save bits here. Why can we leave this off? Because there's a definition an acknowledge must always follow immediately after a transmission. That's the first rule. Second, only the one station is allowed to send acknowledge which has received the packet. So we can leave off the MAC address of this access point because he was the receiver of the previous packet. So he must be the one acknowledging this packet. So we can leave off the source address of this station. And this on Wireshark looks then a little bit strange, something you normally don't see. But you see then empty fields here in the acknowledges. So let's open up here a trace file, one which you also have available. Files now. For example, if we go to the data 01 here, and if you open this up, you will see here frames, and then you will see an acknowledge after the frames. And if you don't see the acknowledge, then the frame will be retransmitted. We'll see this in a minute. You see here? A sync frame, so this is the three-way handshake, starting with sync frame. We see in the air an acknowledge, then we see the SYNAC, an acknowledge, and the ACK, an acknowledge. And the acknowledge has only one MAC address, the one of the receiver. So we have two stations involved here, obviously. The Cisco is the access point, and the Philips is the client. So this frame must have been sent from Philips to Cisco, because then Cisco sent the acknowledge to the Philips. So this is the first thing which is very different. We see acknowledges of every packet, but the acknowledges don't have a source address. It's actually not needed, because we can say where this acknowledge must have come from. Again, let's go back. What happens if a frame is not acknowledged? I mentioned it quite a few times, but it's very important to understand. The sender is responsible for retransmitting. It has nothing to do with TCP or whatever. It's layer 2 here. The wireless card is retransmitting a packet. So even UDP or any other broadcast, any packet is transmitted until you receive the acknowledge. Of course, this is only visible in the air. You won't see anything on this side here. So all the following packets are sent with the RBIT set. And it could be dozens of packets. It may even start negotiating down the speed or going back to one channel. So it's actually reducing all the features and took him away and tries and tries and tries and tries. You may see dozens of retransmissions before it gives up, until you receive the acknowledge. But now, that's exactly the point. We can make a filter and see how many retransmissions in percent, how many packets have been sent with the RBIT. And if this is 50% or more, then you know something is bad. Something is probably bad on layer 1. A lot of packets will not arrive at the destination. That's what we're going to see next in our trace file with the name retransmission. So open up this trace file. If you want to follow or look at here, it's called retransmissions. And Okay. Again, it's a trade spar which has been made in different channels. And just one of the attendees told me that he has even a more sophisticated profile. He even changes the color according to the signal strength, right? Wow, good idea, right? So you can do anything with it. That's really great. You see that this is an old profile, and it won't appear in this, you know, this new, how do you call it, intelligent scroll bar, right? The intelligent scroll bar only shows background colors. So I all have white here. So what I quickly do is I change the background color just to show you that it works. I change the background color and then you can see how these packets will appear in your, which channel are we in here? We are channel one. Okay, what I quickly do is I change here the background color and then it will be visible instead of, okay, red on red, that's nice. So, you may change your background color and then you will see here in the intelligent scroll bar, now you will see the colors. So, if you have white as a background, you won't see it in the scroll bar. That's the trick. Anyway, I just want to show you the retry bit. It's part of the header. And it's actually here in the frame control field in the flags. And it's a retry bit, which is normally set to 0. And whenever it's set to 1, like on my screen, it means this frame has been transmitted already. So it's a real reliable indication that the sender has not received an acknowledge. So it's better than the FCS. So what I just did a filter on retry bit. And if you don't have one with the right, then you just do prepare, you know this. Prepare selected, and then you can turn the value from 1 to 0. From 0 to 1, and now you can apply it, and then you have it. And then, once you have it, you can make a button, a quick filter button, which I recommend. You just press this plus button and give it a name, and it's stored in your profile. So actually, I could have done it much quicker, just by pressing this retry button here, and I have all my packets with the retry set. But now you see down here, you see the percentage of packets which are set with the retry. And this is far too high, 45%. This is far too high.
What is normal?
Normal is up to 10%, could be pretty normal.
So that's healthy, but 20% is unhealthy.
You know, it's like with collision in Ethernet, the same question, what is normal, right?
Yeah, when you really...
I would say make a measurement when your network is running and take this as the normal, even if it's at 50%. Take the measurement as long as nobody complains, that's normal. Yeah, it's really hard to say. We can quickly test what's in here, what's normal in here. Life. Yes, I have all the adapters still running. Let's quickly make a live trace and see what we have here in the room. Maybe you do some downloading also at the moment. I'm listening to all the channels now again and 3% now. Okay, it's not too busy at the moment, obviously. This is live now in all channels. Yes, that's a good value, 4%. But it's not black and white here. You cannot say, okay, beyond 10. But I realized up to 10, nobody complains. Nobody realizes. So, but yeah, that's what I say. You have to get your feeling for your own network. So here nobody complains, but we still have already 3.8% lost. That would be a hell in Ethernet, right? If you have that in Ethernet, then you should do something, right? It's not the case here, because these packets are retransmitted, remember? They still arrive. In TCP, in Ethernet, you would have an end-to-end retransmission, or a packet loss. You don't have it here. It's just in the air. That's the retry bit, which is valuable here, which I recommend. Make this kind of, and actually if you copied my profile, you already should have this button, because they are part stored in the profile. Yes. Okay. So that's how it looks here in this, with these acknowledges. With 11N, a block acknowledge has been introduced. They find out that this ping pong dialogue, one packet, one acknowledge, consumes bandwidth. Of course, it's not very efficient, even though you can leave off the source. So they added a new feature called block acknowledge. So whenever you have an 11N adapter, he's able to do block acknowledge, which allows up to acknowledge up to 64 packets in one go. It's not always like this, because you have to buffer the packets and you don't want to wait too long. So what you do, you accumulate the packets and send it out, maybe only 6 or 5 or 8. Here you see a number of packets sent out, and they are acknowledged with one new acknowledge. You can acknowledge up to 64 packets in one go. And every packet individually is acknowledged. So if packet number 25 has a bad FCS, it's not acknowledged and retransmitted. How do they do this? They use a new technique called bitmap. So they have 64 bits here, and as long as the bits are all 1, it means I have received all packets, whether 10 or 15 or 64. I always have the block map of 64. Now you see here that one packet is missing. Why? Because if you decode A, E to binary, you can tell which packet was missing. And Wireshark offers this now, since a few version. You can do here, right click and look at it in binary if you want. We don't do this here, but that's how it works with block acknowledge. And that's a big improvement, because you can what's called use aggregation. Aggregation mode. The frames have following condition. They must go to the same destination. They must have the same quality of service, but still it speeds up. What Wireshark actually does, it collects the packets and decodes them in the last packet. So that's, you have to get used to it. So the line you see here is actually then the total of all packets. So it does not decode all the packets individually. It collects them, like with the TCP we saw this morning, this reassemble feature. So it collects all the packets and presents you all the collected data in the last packet of a transmission. And you see here, that's nice here, 300 megabits. Only available with 2 channels, and two streams. I'm going to show you a list with these speeds later. So we have the individual acknowledges, and we have this block acknowledges. Of course, the block acknowledge has a source address present, which you see here, transmitter and receiver address. So we only have two addresses. Again, makes sense. We are not forwarding this packet behind the access point. That's a local significance. Okay, let's go through important packets for the remaining only 35 minutes. So let's start with the beacon. All these packets now have its special rule and provide you with important information. So let's start with the beacon. I selected here one of the latest generation. It's an AC wave 1 beacon, and beacon is, I mentioned it already, sent out by default roughly 10 times a second. You can change this, but it's not recommended. Leave it as it is. It contains, of course, the SSID, but it contains a lot of more information. And again, here you can verify if the information is what you configured. Again, we had situations here where some configured values were not applied. Here is what actually is. If you go into the beacon, you see a field called fixed parameter. These parameters are always present. They are not that interesting, but the tag parameters are the optional one. And here, the access point announces what he supports. And this is really nice. You can read a lot out of this information. For example, supported rates here and the so-called basic rates. Country code should be correct, because the customer should, the client before it assigns, should know which channel and which power level. So be aware that this code is, country code is correct. HD capabilities. HD means high throughput. That's 11N extension. So this guy can do 11N. That means it can do aggregation, it can do channel bonding, it can do multiple streams. But how many streams and how many bonding? Bonding is only two channel in 11N, but how many streams? You can have two, three, or four streams. That's all in here. So these beacons actually get longer and longer. One day we'll have the cell full of beacons, right? Because every 10 times a second, so they consume quite a bit of bandwidth. And they get longer and longer with this information. The newest one even have very high throughput. You see here, high throughput is 11N. Very high throughput is AC. And then we have some vendor specific. So this is to inform the client what this access point can offer. But not only what it can offer, also what is required. This is in the element so-called robust security network. Here we are talking about encryption. The wire, the access point can ask for encryption type. And it's not like with all the other options. Nice to know, I offer it, but you may not use it. This is, of course, not the case for the security, right? Access point is not asking, do you want to do security or not, right? In this element, what is in here must be able to be fulfilled by the client. And if it's not, cannot be fulfilled, it will not join. And that's the first step where a client can be 2 meters beside an access point, and it will keep probing. It will keep probing, it hears beacon, it gets probe request, it will never do any step further. If there is one point in here which cannot be fulfilled, it's useless to apply for joining. So this is, for example, this is WPA number 2 with AES and it's pre-shared key, PSK. So it's not certificate, but it's PSK and it's not WPA, it's WPA. So if a client is not able to do this, end of the show, before it even started. So the beacons are actually the first step a client must take to go into the next process. So keep an eye on your beacon. In the earlier days, we had to be sure that they were consistent. We had 60 access points, we had no controller. We had to configure 60 access points manually, right? But they should announce the same feature, right? Would be wise. Today is no problem, right? You do it. You change a feature on your controller and it's sent out to all the access points immediately. So consistency is not an issue anymore, but it used to be hard work to verify that all the controllers have the same setting. So these are the elements here. I explained them what they are for. And actually, you can do a lot of tuning already. For example, with the speed here. If you announce all the speeds, that means you also allow all the speeds. So the slowest speed you allow in this cell is 6 megabit, which is the lowest for 5 gig. That means you even allow clients which are the very end of the cell and which can only talk 6 meg. That's what you say. But you are aware that these clients bring down your cell throughput, right? Because they consume a lot of time to send their packets. If you do not want this, then you remove this speed on your controller. And then it will not appear here. It will just be missing. And this would mean that you shrink your cell. That means the client, let's say you remove 6 and 9, make the minimum speed 12. That means whenever a client reaches this end out of a cell with 12 meg, the client must look for another cell. It must start to roam. And it does this with probes. We are going to see this. It will probe other channels. Okay, if you have a gap then, right, it will disconnect. So you should have overlapping cells with 12 or higher, and then you can avoid, you know, it's even a word for it, it's called sticky client. A client connecting with 6 megabit on the access point down the corridor, sitting behind 1-2 meters with a sending with whatever 50-50, it's called sticky client. It's always driver issue because roaming is a decision or still a decision from the client. They try to take the decision away more and more to the controller, but it's still a decision of the client. And there are a lot of driver problems in these clients. And if the clients try to stick on this access point, if you allow it with the speed, it may happen if you disable it. So these are the tuning possibilities which you can do here. And everything you configure, you can immediately see in the beacon. So it's directly fielding one of these fields. What does the client do? Whenever you start up a client, it has to look for access points. There are two ways of doing it. One is just passive, by listening. You won't see anything with Wireshark. And the most frequent one is active, with probe request. So this is a trace we've seen before. We see that a client is scanning the channels for SSID. And what it actually does, it scans for SSIDs already known and for broadcast. So be careful if you tell your client he should store this SSID. That's what you see. The SSID will be visible afterwards in your probe request. And there have been cases where at the airport you can have men in the middle just set up quickly an access point which sends out this SSID, and your iPhone will connect and will present you the logon screen from the airport, and you won't even realize that it's connected through a man in the middle. So from time to time it's wise to clear this list of stored network, because your devices are sending this out, and maybe it's an old one you want. If you're sending out a specific SSID, only access points which support this SSID will reply. If you send out the broadcast, all access points will reply, except the one which have hidden SSID. The one which have hidden SSID will only reply if you ask for their specific name. So that's why you see a lot of probe requests here from the same station. And you see how it counts up, and you see how it counts through the channels, and that's what happens. And whenever you have a client, it's always sending out probe requests. That's what it always does. As soon as you turn on the wireless, it sends out probe requests. In the States, they're already using this for tracking your pass through shopping mall, right? They grab your MAC address and follow your probe request. You don't even assign, right? It's just your MAC address. And you can tell him, okay, he looked very, very close on women's clothing or whatever, so we can make a profile of your movement. And just by not even connecting, just by looking for this mechanism. Apple, by the way, I think it's Apple now randomized the MAC address, so they change it from time to time. So the track gets lost and the new one comes on or something. So there are a lot of tricks and tricks against. So, but be aware, and that's actually why a client which is not connected to an access point consumes more power than the one which is connected. So that may happen to you if you forget to turn off your phone in the airplane. It may be empty when you land, because it's probing all the times. Once you're connected, you're still probing, preparing for roaming, but in a less frequent interval. But depends on the probing profile. Again, a lot of these things are proprietary, and every vendor claims to have the best algorithm, but they don't tell you how they do it. So there's a lot of freedom. I've seen clients which probe channel 1 and 6 and 11 more than all the others. I've seen clients which just continuously scan through all. So there's a lot of freedom how you do it. A lot of things are not defined, and sometimes it works, and sometimes it ends up in conflict. In the probe requests, you see also the capabilities of a client. So also a client has capability. So this client is a high throughput 11N and an AC. Okay, so you see what the client supports. Now they should find each other. The access points should come back with a probe response. And in the probe response, we have exactly the same information like in a beacon. It's just a unidirected frame, it's not a broadcast. But it contains all the fields in a beacon. It's actually a forced beacon. And now, after the client scan through all the channels, we should have a list of all available APs. And it should compare the features, it should compare the SSID, it should compare the signal strengths. And then again, we do not know why and how the decision is made to join a specific access point. Also here we see different strange things. We have two access point announcing exactly the same thing, but the client decides to take the one over there. There's not much you can do about this. It's just a lot of things are not defined and are free. So as long as it doesn't hurt anybody, you have to just accept. Okay. So how do you realize to which access point the client is going to connect? You realize it with the next two kind of frames, the authentication and association. So this is the next step. And this one goes to only one access point now, and to only one SSID, and exactly to the MAC address of this SSID. So if you have multiple SSID, I mentioned every has a different MAC, and then it will be the MAC address of this SSID. So the next step is now the authentication and association request. So here the client asks for association. Actually, this is old stuff here. The authentication is not done anymore here. That used to be WEP stuff, but WEP is not used anymore. So this is legacy frames here. You will see them all the time, but you will never see a refusion of authentication these days. That's legacy stuff. But the association is important. Here you should get a positive response. Otherwise, something is wrong in your access point configuration, does not accept this client for whatever reason. Maybe MAC address filtering or something like this. We are not in the negotiation and authentication process yet. So it must be something based on what the client has delivered. And at the moment, it's not much more than the MAC address. So I very rarely see a refusion at this stage here. So now we are associated with one access point. That means the access point has made note of my MAC address and keeps forwarding packet to my MAC address. But you may need key negotiation. We have seen in the beacon that this access point requires pre-shared key, WPA, and then we will see the following key negotiation. For example, you see that the access point is sending a key message 1. It's obviously not acknowledged, so just send out the second time, within a millisecond, you see? And that's really very close, you won't even realize. So this second packet would be marked with a retry bit. You can verify this if you want. So this happens very, very often, that you see some packet duplicate. That's pretty normal. Now you get back packet 2 or 4, 3 or 4. So what they do is mutual authentication and key negotiation here. So you know that the pre-shared key, the one you configure on both sides, is never going to be used as the encryption key. It's used together with a nonce value to form a session key. So even if all the clients have the same pre-shared key, they never will use the same key for encryption. That's the big difference to WEP. And therefore, this system is much more reliable. In addition, you can change the key whenever you want and form a new session key and so on. If you want to decode packets with Wireshark, it's important that you have these four keys here, these key messages. Because even if you have the pre-shared key, and you have to have it and configure it, and I'll show you, if you have time, probably not. The pre-shared key on its own will not be of any use. So Wireshark has to follow these nonce values. He takes these nonce values, and again, also forms the session key. And only then it will be listened and able to decode. If you miss this key because you started capturing too late, then you will see the data frames, but you will see them as encrypted packet. and will not be able to decode it. So let's open here quickly a file with a client churning. Yes, there is time to show that and show you the encryption, how you configure, and let's close some of these files here. Open. It's actually WPA with pre-shared key. And again, we see the process we already know. We see beacon frames here. We see probe requests, probe responses. We see the association authentication process. Everything we should understand now. Go a little bit down. Here it is. Then we see the key messages. And I have the pre-shared key present. You cannot use Wireshark to hack the pre-shared key. The pre-shared key will never be sent through the air. So you have to have the key, and you can enter it on your wireless toolbar. Go to preferences and go to keys. And I tell you the key here. You don't have it in the trace file. The key will be 123 and so on, 90. And as soon as you have the key, so you have to enter the key here, and you have to select WPA password and not pre-shared key. Unfortunately, you cannot read all the letters here. So anyway, as soon as you have this key available, turn on enable encryption, and then you should have this. You see it here on the color. You should see, as soon as the negotiation is passed, you should see well-known behavior, like on the wire. Here you see the HTTP request. Of course, again, always with the acknowledge in between, but the rest, of course, is the same. The client has to ask for an IP address and all this stuff. Okay. How much time we have left? Okay. Yeah, I have to jump over some of these traces here. I have a problem with a client taking a long time to join. What it actually does, it several times started negotiation and key negotiation, and then it started probing again and things like this. Actually, if you see that behavior, what can you do to solve it? It's not much you can do, because this is a driver issue. But first, you find out whether the problem is on the access point side or on the client side. Many times you have no idea, right? And you don't know where to go next. With Wireshark, you can at least find out, okay, in this case, it seems to be the client misbehaving. What can you do next? You can check whether there is a new driver available, right? There's not much more you can do. So, my recommendation is, whenever I get a call from a customer, I do not go out without asking him, did you update all the drivers, right? Because at the end, there may be the conclusion anyway. So why not do it right from the beginning? It may save you a lot of effort and a lot of... You never will know what the problem was, but it works, right? So updating the driver is always the first thing you have to do. Anyway, if you don't have an updated driver, you will not get any support from any vendors, right? You can report errors and they say, load the latest driver. So there are a lot of driver issues there, out there, and all you can do is drive the latest driver. If not, then you can report the problem to your vendor. Try it. You will be the only one having that problem on the world. That's the answer. So yeah. Anyway, that's for example here. Yes. Here is another stuff, another example. A client was trying to join, and finally, after certain time, gives up. And they authenticate. In this case, we see proper authentication, we see proper association, but we see that it stops after key message 2. In key message 2, the client must have digested the nonce value received in message 1 and must give this value to the access point. And now it checks the identity of this. And obviously, we had the wrong pre-shared key. So the client did not have the right key, so it just stops. Unfortunately, you don't see any error message like something wrong key or so. It would be much easier, but you don't have it. It just stops. The client is not served anymore. So the client has to, the client has to try again and tries again, but after a while it gives up. You have this trace file, I don't open it here because I have one which is even more challenging. Yeah, let's look, have a quick look at roaming. As I said, roaming is always a critical process. We have a lot of problems going out from roaming, because roaming means a new association, and this is always critical, or may be critical, but not necessarily, but it may be critical. Here you see a client, it's actually a Philips client, which is associated in the red channel number 1. You see this here in the previous, but then the client starts to change the channel and associates in channel 11 here. So the channel 11 becomes much stronger. Look at the beacons. The signal to noise ratio is 71 and here it's only 23. You look at the beacon. So the Philips is now changing, sending a reassociation request. It's similar to an association, but it should speed up the process if it's implemented. And actually, this is a matter of 4 milliseconds. So if everything works fine, this may be a very quick process. So, okay, if you have key negotiation, then you will see key negotiation again here. But the roaming process actually is finished here. So not a big issue, but here nice to see with two adapters. So you won't see any messages from Philips in the old channel. It doesn't say goodbye or something, it just moves away without any message. The access points realize on their distribution system size that the Philips has moved. They send out a fake message with Philips as a source. And then the old access point removes the Philips from its table. So this was really a hard situation on a customer side, finger pointing since weeks and months between vendor, I don't tell you the name, but if you look at the MAC address, you may find out. So, vendor of access points and vendor of barcode. A customer was complaining, my barcode scanner freezes from time to time, there's a panel, touch panel, and it freezes up to minutes, sporadically. And they were finger pointing for a long time. The barcode provider was asking to change parameters on the infrastructure side. First the signal was too strong, then it was too weak, then it should change the beacon interval. The client got me an Excel list of what they have told him to do, right? They almost tried every parameter which is available. They had no idea what they should do. And on the same side, the people from the infrastructure claimed, we have no problem with other devices. You have a lot of other devices in your area. The only problem is with this barcode scanner. And the barcode scanner said, we have this barcode scanner in use all over the customers. You're the only one, right? You know this situation. Nobody will move anymore. And customer was not happy. So I got involved in that. And when in such critical situation, when I go to the customer, I ask that the representative of all parties involved is on the spot, right? Otherwise they would not accept what I'm saying anyway, right? Oh, just another one pointing to us, no, okay. So I asked somebody from the provider from this access point and from the client side. They have to be present together with the customer. I want them to be there, and maybe they can tune something right on the spot that would shorten the whole process, maybe not. So in this case, we had no idea what was the problem when we started. We didn't have any key available. It was certificates. So we'll have no chance to see any data. So let's quickly open this up and try to do this live, because it will show you that you okay. I think it's not on the list, huh? Yes. I think that's my purpose, because it's a customer file. Okay. Yes, I have to shorten it a little bit. What we find out is the following. I followed the client with the MAC address, Zebratec, because we were told this is the device, one of the devices having a problem. But again, here it was not well reproducible, though we used the full day until it happened once. If you analyze roaming problem, you should follow with your device close to the client. If you are analyzing cell problems, you stay close to the access point, because in a cell all the stations must hear the access point. So here we follow the client. You see the signal from the client is quite strong, -75 signal to noise. That's very strong signal. The signal from the access point may vary. The MCAPay may become weaker or stronger. Anyway, what we find out that at some point it really happened. And the authentication, we saw afterward that the roaming was actually the initiator, that the roaming was not the real problem, because the roaming was actually finished here with the reassociation response. But then the access point was asking for the identity of this new client, which is pretty normal. And the answer to that should be a response identity with the client's value. Instead, nothing happened, no reply, and after 30 seconds, the client was thrown off with a deauthentication. So he retried again and again. So it happened 3 to 4 times. So that means 30 seconds, 60 seconds, 90 seconds, that was the interval. And certainly it worked. Now, the problem is, how can you tell if this request identity has arrived at the client side? Because if this identity has not arrived, the Cisco should retransmit it. If it has arrived, the client should send the identity response. So the key issue is, can we tell whether this packet here has arrived? The packet number 83. It's a request identity, right? What should we see after this request identity? An acknowledge. Do we see an acknowledge? No. So why does Cisco not retransmit this packet? And now, be very careful. Look at this filter here. We have a filter on the MAC address of the symbol. Now think yourself, if you learn something during these hours, in an acknowledge from Cisco to the symbol, vice versa, in an acknowledge from the symbol to the Cisco, would we have the address of the symbol?
No.
Why not? We only have the Cisco, right? So with this filter here, we would not see the acknowledge. Got the point? That's really critical. Because once I release this filter, we saw the acknowledge here. Right? Which means now the Oscar goes to Cisco or Zebra. And my Oscar in this case is the one who has to work, right? Zebra.
Because absolutely. It have said the identity
absolutely. You see the point? If Zebra acknowledged that it has the frame received, it should continue with the response. And it didn't. Okay. It was everybody was clear now after this, not after this, but after removing the filter, that it was Zebra's fault. And you won't believe it, after a week we had a new driver and it worked. Before they didn't do anything, right? Suddenly they had a new driver. Okay? So these are the things which you can do by understanding, and now it becomes clear why you have to understand the different type of frames, the different type of addresses, because here you make the wrong conclusion, because you say, okay, I don't see the acknowledge to this. Obviously, if you don't have an acknowledge, then the Cisco should retransmit. But it doesn't, so the bug is on Cisco. No, it isn't. In this case, because we, with this filter, you won't see an acknowledge issued by a Zebra. Okay, let's go to, I'm over time already. Yes, I just tried again to make an overview, give me 2 more minutes, because it's kind of confusing how many standards we have these days. So there are a lot of lists also available on the internet. What I did here is just to show you what we have today available. Especially in the 2.4 band, we have 4 generations sitting one beside the other. And the same starts here in the 5 gig. We have the A, the A, the AN, and the V, the very high throughput now. And this mixture of protocols and generations also causes a lot of problem. Because you have, does anybody still have B clients in this network? B only? Barcode scanner or what?
Printer.
Okay. So if you have B clients, you never will come up to speed. They bring down your whole network because the new clients have to use protection. And they have to send out clear to send frames, which you see here. Request to send, clear to send. to reserve airtime. So there's a rule of thumb. Try to avoid more than two generations of client. So if you have B clients, don't invest too much money in access points 11N. Invest your money to get rid of the B clients. Right? It doesn't help if you have access point of the latest generation and you have clients of too early. Or move the new clients to a new network. That's what I see often. Move the new clients to the A network, leave the old. But don't invest money here in 11N if you have B clients. Either get rid of them, or if you don't, cannot get rid of them, then try to move to another gen. So that's the message here. I don't have to, cannot spend any more time, but another list is here. One thing I already mentioned here, the AirPcap NX which we have can only follow here up to two streams and two channels, but there's much more here. You know, we are going up in the future to eight channel and eight streams with the 6900 here. So that's a list which may help you to orient a little better, because there are a lot of terms out there and a lot of confusing terms, and here you can use this list for clarification. Okay, no time for questions, but I will be here for a few more minutes if there are any questions. Thank you very much for following me, and please fill in this A-Balls, and maybe see you another time here or wherever. Thank you very much.